Let me ask you something. Have you had problems writing checks, paying bills, balancing a checkbook recently? How about assembling tax records? That's always a problem. Or business affairs or papers. How about a problem in shopping alone for clothes, household necessities, or groceries? How about playing a game of skill or working on a hobby? Heating water, making a cup of coffee, turning the stove off after use. That's actually an issue that I've started having over the past year. Doug Thompson, the dentist founder of the Wellness Dentistry Network, and I were having a conversation the other day, and we started talking about dentists and patient awareness, dentists helping in patient awareness for Alzheimer's. Is that crazy or what? Actually, it's not crazy at all. Periodontitis has been linked many, many times to the development of Alzheimer's disease. In studies like this one, how gum disease could lead to the development of Alzheimer's. And in this one, they showed that patients who had 10 years or more of periodontitis were 70% more likely to develop Alzheimer's. Now, what could be a possible role for dentists, and what interests would they have? I'll let Doug talk about that. Then a little bit later in the video, I'll just give you some reminders of what we've done in terms of MOCA, what the MOCA looks like, when to do a MOCA, and the Mini-Cog as well. So a couple of different ways at screening for dementia.
Thanks, Ford. With our Wellness Dentistry Network and through our program, we're trying to get dentists to control oral biofilm, and typically the oral biofilm that cause gum disease. Gum disease is caused by bacteria, yeast, and viruses. And you and I were talking about it, and we teach dentists about, we give dentists methodologies to teach their patients in an easy way about gum disease and what the big deal is. And so we use bleeding gums, we use teeth flaring, people with bad breath, measuring the pockets around the teeth. I mean, it's really, really important to do. And we know that what the root of this, or the initiating factor of this disease, is bacteria, different bacteria that live in the mouth. So we have these tests that we can do to measure these bacteria. And these are simple swish and spit tests that we can get for 30, 40 seconds. You can have someone swish and spit in a cup, and you can get these bacteria. And usually what signals us that we need that is this bleeding gum. So if you see any blood on your floss or your toothbrush, that's probably even a later stage disease. So we do this when we measure, we look at bleeding when we measure our pocket depth. And then we realize that these bacteria on these reports, they give us this information about the concentration and level of bacteria, but these reports also remind us that these bacteria cause other problems: cancer, colorectal cancer, pancreatic cancer, cardiovascular disease. You and I have done other pieces on cardiovascular disease, joint health. But this is what got my attention today, is this dementia and brain health issue. So one of the issues when we do these tests for it is that we get a report back, and this report tells us what bacteria are really in the mouth and what concentration it is. And not only does the company tell us about bacterial presence, but they remind us that these bacteria are also implicated in these other diseases, you know, cancer, colorectal cancer, pancreatic cancer, other cancers, cardiovascular health. You know, you and I have done other pieces on cardiovascular health and how oral bacteria affect that, but muscle and joint health. And then, of course, came dementia and brain health. And when I saw dementia and brain health, well, in addition, there's metabolic health and pregnancy as well. But when I was looking at dementia and brain health, I was trying to think about how could dentists help their patients become aware of what their current level of cognitive either decline or cognitive just cognitive condition is. And that's when you mentioned to me about some of these different assessments. And I know you, through PrevMed, and through, you know, I know people can learn a lot on your Ford Brewer or YouTube channel, you know, about these kind of things in a number of formats. But one of the services you provide is some kind of testing. You told me it's got Montreal in the name, so that's why I wanted to call and have you, you know, tell me a little bit more about that.
So thank you. I think what you're referring to is MOCA, Montreal Cognitive Assessment. It takes about half an hour to do that, at least in order to administer it. It has some basic psychomotor neurological testing components. For example, the patient has to follow some dots and have to figure out how to accomplish some things while following the dots. They have to do some very basic things like be oriented. In fact, I did a video where I went through one of those, and I'll send you that video after this is done, where it goes through the actual details of the test. I didn't flunk it. I did pretty well, but here's the one place I did miss. I got the wrong date. I'm always so that's a part of orientation for time and place. But it's a good test. It's you do have to get training in terms of standardization on how to administer it, how to grade it, and how to counsel with the patient regarding what it says, and then how to interpret it. As I was getting our group geared up to look a little bit more at dementia, we looked through several different types of tests. As you and I have discussed Cambridge earlier, I know we looked at that. At this point in time, I don't remember all of the pluses and minuses. I do remember this, though, that the MOCA appeared to be the most rigorous, the most widely used, and the best gauge for what we were doing. It was reassuring when I went down for training with Dale Bredesen. Just about every other word out of his mouth was MOCA this, MOCA that. He uses it heavily in his assessments as well. So that helped us in terms of fitting well with the Dale Bredesen activities. So those are the basics. Yes, as you mentioned, Janice does provide it. Dr. Derrickson is works in our group. She's had training in it. She got certified in it, and she provides that for our patients. That's on one of our options as well.
Great. And I know we have that listed in your list of services in our Wellness Dentistry Network Partners in Health section. The WDN member dentist can go there and look up that information. And for any docs out there that want to find a dentist too that can refer, they can refer to, they can always go to the wellnessdentistrynetwork.com and look at the member directory and find these dentists. But we would hope our dentists would be aware that there's a connection between gum disease, oral bacteria, yeast and viruses, and brain health. And thanks, Ford, for giving us an option to have our patients, be able to have somebody qualified to help them determine where they are in their journey with dementia and heart disease, or dementia and Alzheimer's. I know it's a big, big problem for the future.
Absolutely. Thank you, Doug, for what you do. I think one of the biggest untapped potentials that we have from a public health manpower perspective in dealing with the number one cause of death with heart attack, the number one cause of disability with stroke right now, and rapidly becoming the number one cause of both with dementia, is the dental community. And the dentists, the dentists have a unique opportunity to help in this area.
Again, for folks that score four or less on a Mini-Cog, you want to go ahead and do what's called a MOCA. Now, this is the S MOCA, meaning the sequenced MOCA. And if you remember the Mini-Cog, it basically had two major components: remembering a list of three words and being able to draw the hands of a clock. Now, this has the same thing. It has those two. You start off with the three words, then you go to what's called a sequence, some attention span by subtracting 100, 7 from 100, and 7 from that, and 7 from that. Then abstraction, language, orientation, naming, delayed recall, the clock face, and again, you get a score on all that. I'll just run through these fairly quickly with you. One of them, they do a different type of memory recall. This one is five words. I was reading this earlier. I believe it is now. And again, maybe I'm teaching you to cheat here on the exam. Maybe not. Here's the sequence. Basically, what you're looking for on this next test is go from 1 to A, 2 to B, 3 to C,